Hello dear students, this video is the continuation of our previous video on absorptions by roots. We had discussed up to endosmosis and exosmosis. In this video, we will continue with the osmotic pressure. Here, in this experimental setup, you can see there is a beaker containing water and inverted thruster funnel which is filled with sugar solution, and mouth of this thruster funnel is covered by a semi-permeable membrane. Here the semi-permeable membrane is cellophane paper. Here this setup is discussing osmosis. The concentration of water is more in this beaker compared to inside this thruster funnel in this sugar solution. So water will move from the region of their higher concentration to the region of their lower concentration through semi-permeable membrane. It means water will enter into this thruster funnel through this cellophane paper. Cellophane paper here acts as a semi-permeable membrane. What will be the result? The solution level will rise in this thruster funnel, and the level of water will decrease in this beaker. Water level decrease in this beaker and the sugar solution will rise in this thruster funnel. But how long this osmosis will continue? Theoretically, we can see when the concentration of water inside the thruster funnel and outside the thruster funnel becomes equal, that time osmosis will stop. But practically, this is different from the theoretical. Here, when the column of this sugar solution rises and rises, it gain weight, and that weight exert pressure downward. This pressure reduces the osmosis. One stage will come when there will be no osmosis due to the pressure. Even the concentration of water inside the thruster funnel and outside the thruster funnel are different. This minimum pressure which stops the osmosis is known as osmotic pressure. Here in this this experimental setup, you can see same setup. Only difference is that one weight is provided with the help of this piston. This weight exert pressure, and that pressure stop the entry of water into the solution. How much pressure is that is minimum pressure that stop the entry of water into the solution, and that minimum pressure is known as osmotic pressure. By definition, we can say osmotic pressure is the minimum pressure that must be exerted to prevent the passage of pure solvent into solution when the two are separated by semi-permeable membrane. So here, when weight exerted by this pressure exerted by this weight stop the entry of this water into the thruster funnel, that pressure is known as osmotic pressure. Osmotic pressure is the minimum pressure that must be exerted to prevent the passage of pure solvent into this solution when they are separated by this semi-permeable membrane. Now we understood that waters move from higher concentration to lower concentration. Means water moves if concentrations are different, relative concentrations are different. Take this relative concentration that determines the direction and extension of diffusion is known as tonicity. Now we'll talk about tonicity. Tonicity is the relative concentration of solution that determines the direction and extent of diffusion. Take on the basis of tonicity, solutions are of three different types: isotonic solution, hypotonic solution, and hypertonic solution. First, we'll talk about isotonic solution. The solution in which the concentration of water molecules both side of the semipermeable membrane are equal, then that is called isotonic solution. Since both side concentration of solution is equal, there will be no osmosis. No osmosis is taking place when the concentration is isotonic solution. Now, if a cell, we take example of a cell, when cell is kept in any isotonic solution, the size and shape of the cell will not affect. There will be no change in shape and size of the solution because no osmosis is taking place in isotonic solution. Now we'll talk about hypotonic solution and hypertonic solution. Hypo means lower, less, under. Take hyper means higher, more. This hypotonic or hypertonic is based on the solute concentration outside the cell. When we are talking about hypotonic solution, it means solution having lower concentration of solute outside the cell. If outside the cell concentration of solute is lower, it means concentration of solvent is more. When this concentration of solvent is more outside the cell, so water will move from outside to inside. Means it causes endosmosis. When a cell is kept in hypotonic solution, endosmosis will take place, and due to that, the size of the cell enlarges, and even some cases the cell bursts. Now we will talk about hypertonic solution. Hypertonic solution means the concentration of solute outside the cell is less. If concentration of solute outside the cell is concentration of solute outside the cell is higher. If the concentration of solute outside the cell is higher, it means concentration of solvent outside the cell is less. It means water from inside the cell will move outside the cell. It causes exosmosis. When a cell is kept in any hypertonic solution, exosmosis will take place and the cell will shrink and it will lose its shape. So understood here, if a cell is kept in isotonic solution, there will be no change in shape and size of the cell. If a cell is kept in hypotonic solution, the size of the cell will enlarge and even in some cases the cell burst. Now when the cell is kept in hypertonic solution, the cell will shrink and it will lose its size. Here one thing I want to discuss you, when we are talking about hypotonic solution, hypotonic solution resulted into osmosis. means cell absorb more and more water. ठीक, तो when cell absorb more and more and more water, one stage is come when the cell is not able to accommodate any more water. At that stage, the cell is said to be rigid. The cell is said to be turgid cell. The stage in which the cell is not able to accommodate any more water inside it, at that stage, cell is said to be turgid. And the condition of the cell that time is called turgidity. So, what is turgidity? Turgidity is the condition of cell or a stage of cell where the cell wall fully stretched and becomes rigid because of increase of volume of vacuoles due to the continuous inflow of water. Take. So this is a turgidity. Achha, here some examples are given when the cells are kept in different type of solution. These are animal cell, that is RBC cell, red blood cell, and here these are plant cells. Theek. When this RBC cell is placed in any hypotonic solution, the size of the cell will not change, the shape and size remain same. But when the cell is placed in hypertonic solution, due to the exosmosis, the cell will shrink and it will lose its size. And when the cell is kept in a hypotonic solution, it causes endosmosis and the size of the cell will enlarge. And in some cases, cell burst also. Now look at this in plant cell. These are plant cell kept in isotonic, hypertonic, and hypotonic solution. If you see this first, which is kept in isotonic solution, there will be no change in its shape and size. Here, when the plant cell is kept in hypertonic solution, the cell shrink, and when the cell is kept in hypotonic solution, the size of the cell increases. Thick. One features we can obtain here, we can see one features, that is rigidity of this cell wall. Rigidity of this cell wall. Cell is, when it absorbs more and more water, the cell wall becomes rigid. This rigidity helps the cell to protect its inner structure or inner cellular parts. Thick. Now, here we will talk about next important topic, that is active transport. We know that in osmosis, water moves from the region of their higher concentration to the region of their lower concentration. To continue this osmosis, the root cell sap has a higher concentration, higher solute concentration. This root cell contains cell sap, and cell sap at a higher concentration. It means if cell sap is a higher concentration, higher solute concentration, means inside the cell the concentration of water is less. It means outside the cell in soil water concentration is more. So water from outside the cell will move inside the cell. But beyond this, many nutrients such as ions of nitrate, sulfur, potassium, zinc, magnesium, all things are also required by the plants whose concentration outside the cell is less compared to the inside the cell in cell sap. Here, this all nutrients such as salts and ions should go inside the cell from the region of their lower concentration to the region of their higher concentration. For moving from the region of lower concentration to higher concentration, energy is required. By utilizing energy only, these gradients, salts and ions entering into the root hair. This movement or transport of substances, that is salts and ions, from the region of their lower concentration to the region of their higher concentration through a living cell membrane using energy in the form of ATP is known as active transport. See, what is then active transport? Active transport is the passage of substance, and those substances are salts and ions, ions of nitrate, sulfate, potassium, zinc, magnesium, etc., etc., from the lower concentration. Their concentration is low outside the cell and high inside the cell in cell sap. So here these salts and ions from its lower concentration moves to higher concentration inside the cell through a living membrane using energy in the form of ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate, and this transport is known as active transport. This active transport is different from that of passive transport like endosmosis, exosmosis. These are passive transport. In passive transport, no energy is required. Here in active transport, energy is required because here the substance move from the region of their lower concentration to the region of their higher concentration. Now we will talk about turgidity and flaccidity. As I told, when cell absorbs more and more water, one stage comes when the cell is not able to accommodate any more water. It is fully distended, and at that time the cell is called a turgid cell, and the condition of the cell is called the turgidity. As I told it, turgidity is the condition of the cell in which cell wall, here in this picture you can see the cell wall is fully rigid and stretched. By increasing the volume of these vacuoles because of absorption of water. So what is turgidity? Here again I am telling, turgidity is the state of cell in which the cell wall is rigid and stretched. By increasing an volume of this vacuoles due to absorption of water. Take here, when the cell is completely turgid, the cell is fully distended or turgid, what will happen? See, more and more water is entering into this vacuoles. So this vacuoles stretch this inside this, it stretch becomes bigger, increase in size, and this is cytoplasm. So this vacuoles presses this cytoplasm outwardly. Since cytoplasms contain cell, so cell contains along with this cytoplasm, cell contains exert pressure on these cell walls. So that pressure is called turgor pressure. The pressure exerted by cell content on the cell wall is known as turgor pressure. If you are asked what is turgor pressure, your answer will be the pressure exerted by cell content on the cell wall. To counterbalance this turgor pressure, the wall also exert pressure on the cell content, and that pressure is called wall pressure. Wall pressure. What is wall pressure? The pressure exerted by cell walls on the cell content. Why they are doing this? So because to control the trigger pressure. ठीक, this turgid cells also called a cell at a balanced stage because here it is fully distended and the concentration of solute inside the cell may be greater than the outside, but there will be no absorption of water. ठीक, it is at a balanced stage. Now we will talk about plasmolysis and flaccidity. Plasmolysis and flaccidity. Now see here, this cell is fully distended, fully distended stage. So here this cell membrane, or which is known as also plasma membrane, attach or fully touch with this cell wall in this case. Suppose if this cell is now kept in 5% solution of salt, or we can say if the cell is now kept in hypertonic solution, what will happen? This will lose its turgidity because of a withdrawal of water from the cell. When we will keep it in hypertonic solution, there will be exosmosis and water will come out from the cell. Due to that, it will lose its turgidity, and the plasma membrane, this one plasma membrane along with this whole cytoplasm will leave the cell wall, means it comes away from the cell wall. That process is known as plasmolysis. So what is plasmolysis? This one plasmolysis is the contraction of the cytoplasm from cell wall due to withdrawal of water when placed in any hypertonic solution. ठीक, what is plasmolysis? Again telling you, plasmolysis is the contraction of cytoplasm from the cell wall. It comes away from the cell wall due to withdrawal of water when it is placed in hypertonic solution. ठीक, and that stage when it is plasmolyzed, at that stage cell is said to be flaccid cell. Flaccid cell means cell is now no more turgid. ठीक, and the condition of that cell is known as flaccidity. Flaccidity. Now there is one difference between this plasmolysis and flaccidity. In plasmolysis, the cytoplasms shrink away, contract away, move away from the cell wall, and it will lose its turgidity. ठीक, so that is plasmolysis. But in flaccidity, this cell will lose its turgidity. It will comes away from this cell wall. Also, the cell content shrink. Here, in this flaccidity, we can say flaccidity is the condition in which the cell content shrunken and it is no more tight, no more turgid. For more understanding, it is plasmolyzed cell with the cell content shrunken. Thick shrunken cell content, and it is plasmolyzed also. Now here we'll talk about the uses of turgidity. Uses of turgidity. What is the importance of turgidity? Here we can see the first importance of turgidity, that it provide rigidity. It provide rigidity to the soft tissue such as leaves. ठीक, तो when a plant absorbs water, its leaves get water and it is fully stretched. It gives rigidity. Turgidity gives rigidity, and because of that rigidity, it's able to stand fully stretched. But think about the condition when the rate of transpiration is more, means loss of water is more or absorption of water is less, as in case of daytime when the sun is very hot. Daytime the rate of absorption is less and rate of transpiration is more. In this situation, plant leaves loses more water and wilt because it cannot maintain its turgidity. Take wilting due to the loss of water. It occurs during hot day when the rate of transpiration is more and the rate of absorption is less. The situation is changed in the evening when the sun is little dim and the rate of transpiration is here reduced and absorption rate is the same. So it has acquired or it absorbs more and more water, and again the leaves stand out, means it spread itself, means there will be no more wilting, it recover itself. So here turgidity provides rigidity. If plant cell is not rigid, it will not be able to stand by itself. This turgor pressure helps the plant to push through the hard ground and comes out of the ground. You might have seen in some cracked wall also plants grow. This is possible only because of this turgor pressure. Turgor pressure helps the plant to push out through the hard ground and comes out for growth. Turgor pressure built root pressure. Turgor pressure built root pressure that helps in ascent of sap, means upward movement of water molecules. What is this root pressure? Root pressure is nothing. It is the pressure built in the root due to the continuous inflow of water. When water comes inside the cell, it exerts pressure outwardly, which is known as root pressure. Here it is written that root pressure is the pressure developed in root due to continuous inward movement of water through cell to cell osmosis, which help in ascent of sap. Upward through the stem, ascent of sap means rise of sap, movement of sap in upward movement. This root pressure is sometime very high in small plants, very high in small plants, that much high that it pushes the water out of the leaves through their veins. Take that process is known as guttation. Guttation is the loss of water from the leaves or veins of the leaves in the form of droplets of water when the root pressure is very high. So when we cut any plant close to its root, we will find some sap is coming out, some water is coming out. That water is also because of root pressure. Root pressure exerts and this water is pushed out from the cut stem. That process is known as bleeding. What is bleeding? Bleeding is the loss of water from the plant through the injured part, through the cut part, through the wounded part of the plant. Take when our muscles cut, blood is coming out. Similarly, when plants cut, the water is coming out. That is, cell sap is coming out, and that process is known as bleeding. So what is bleeding? Bleeding is the loss of water or loss of cell sap through the injured part of the plant, through the cut part of the plant, through the wounded part of the plant. This turgor pressure also helps in opening and closing of stomata. This whole mechanism of opening and closing of stomata we will study in detail in our next chapter, that is photosynthesis. Now another one important application of this turgor pressure. This turgor pressure causes turgor movement. Turgor movement is nothing the movement caused due to the loss of turgidity. ठीक, the movement caused due to the loss of turgidity is known as Turgor movement. Take one example of this Mimosa pudica. That is touch me not plant. When we touch this not plant, the cell here, this one is petiole. Petiole loses turgidity and the leaves of this Mimosa pudica droops down. This movement of leaves of this sensitive plant called Mimosa pudica is known as Turgor movement. Turgor movement means movement caused due to the loss of turgidity. Now here we will talk about root pressure. Already we have discussed root pressure. Root pressure is the pressure that developed in a root because of inward movement of water. This root pressure, as I told, when it is very high, it causes here guttation. Guttation cause. So what is guttation? Guttation is also the loss of water from the leaves of the plant through the margin of the or vein of the leaves in the form of droplets of water, teeny droplets of water. ठीक, and the small holes, the pore through which the water coming out, ooze out from the leaves vein, that hole is known as hydathorns. Hydathorns is the minute pore, tiny hole through which guttation is taking place. Now here you can see this how water is conducted in the root here. Here water is first absorbed by this root here and it comes through this first epidermis layer. This first cell is pulled completely full, distended, it presses and this liquid or water passes to the another cell. Now this cells becomes a turgid cell, fully turgidity, and this becomes a flat seed cell. Now alternately this turgidity and flaccidity is going. Now this water is passing through the cortex layers of cell, then comes in the endodermis layer, and finally it reaches to this double wall structure called a xylem. ठीक, this the single wall structure is phloem and this double wall structure is xylem, and from here it's conducted in upward direction where root pressure is also playing one role. Root pressure pushes the water, rises the water up to certain extent only, up to certain height only, not very high. Now we'll discuss this importance of root hairs and upward movement of absorbed water and minerals. Now see here, forces contributing to ascent of sap. What are the forces that are responsible for upward movement of sap? Here four important forces are there. One is called root pressure, second one is called capillarity, third one is called transpiration pull, and the fourth one is adhesion and cohesive forces. Theek. First we will talk about root pressure. That root pressure is the pressure that build in a root due to the continuous inward flow of water. This root pressure helps to rise the sap up to certain height. It works in small plants only. Second one is capillarity. This capillarity means narrow diameter. When the diameter is narrow, the pressure is more. So it helps to push water up to more height, upper height. The next is transpiration pull. Transpiration pull. When transpiration taking place through the leaves, it pull the water molecules just beneath it, and similarly the water molecule just beneath it is pulled by the upper molecules. In this way a full chain of water molecules create from the root to the leaves. That pull is known as transpiration pull, and this transpiration pull is caused due to the cohesion force, means force of attraction of between the similar types of molecules, means molecules of water and molecules of water. When the similar type of molecules combined together, attracted together, that force is known as cohesive force, and it is very important for the transpiration pull, because if they are not attracting each other, they are not joined by the cohesion force, they will be no pulling up to the top. So cohesion force plays very important role in transpiration pull or building transpiration pull. Adhesion force is also important in that. Adhesion force is the force of attraction between the different molecules. Suppose here in take example of this, this is suppose xylem, this is suppose xylem, and water molecules is moving up. Water molecules is this attracted by this cohesion force and moving up. Take because from this upside from the leaves, when water evaporates, it pulls the molecules of water just beneath it. In simply, the water molecule just beneath it is pulling. A full chain of this water molecules created here. Suppose when water molecules is going up, it is necessary that it must touch with or attracted with walls of xylem.